Hey, good morning and welcome to Sunnyside, where we are a people following Jesus to those not yet. I'm so glad that you guys are here with us today. My name is Corey, one of the pastors here, and we are gathering together today. Whether you're doing this in person or you're doing this online, I'm so glad that you are with us this morning. Hey, I've been thinking a lot about this thing, and I've come to kind of this observation recently, and here it is. We are intrigued with things that are weird, just things that are abnormal, things that are out of the ordinary. It draws our attention. It kind of attracts our gaze, if you will, and we get intrigued by this stuff. We'll research it. We'll look at it. We'll view it. We'll observe it. We'll go to great extents because it stands out to us. And anything that's outside of the ordinary kind of draws our attention. If I was to tell you that there is actually a people group in Eastern Kentucky in the Appalachian Mountains, and their pigmentation's blue, like they're actually called the blue people of Kentucky, that would probably catch your intrigue, right? As a matter of fact, some of you guys will wait until after this service and you'll go look this up to see if what I'm telling you is true. Some of you guys won't even give me until then. You're going to stop and look it up right now, all right? But I can tell you, like, it's true. There are really blue people in Kentucky, and anytime you see them or hear about them, they stand out. They draw attention. They draw your intrigue. And we are drawn to things that are outside of the ordinary, things that are abnormal, things that are weird, if you will. And there's no shortage of weird things out there. I mean, we have, things like this blue sheep here. Oh, sorry, pink sheep. You know, we got a pink sheep here. If you saw this out in the field, you would stop and you go, what in the world is that? It would catch your gaze. Why? Because it's not normal. Or maybe something like this. If you saw this out in the wild or on an animal channel, you'd be like bringing people in. You'd be like, hey, come take a look at this. You know, there's a two-headed snake that's going on. My son is incredibly intrigued with piranhas right now. I've taken him fishing a couple times, and we don't have piranhas out here, and so it's not a normal thing for us. And so he's been wanting to watch all these videos about piranhas, all right? Maybe if you saw somebody eating this, it would catch your attention, right? You'd be intrigued because M&M's on a pizza is not normal. You want to talk about really weird? Take a look at this guy. That's right. All right. Our very own Pastor Eric, right? He is not normal in any sense of the term. But here's the deal. Okay. Our attention naturally goes to things that are weird, things that are odd, things that are abnormal, things that are out of the ordinary. It is a natural thing for us to be drawn to that. Matter of fact, if everybody walked into a room and we're all wearing black, but somebody was wearing red, your eyes would automatically go to that particular thing. That's just where our attention goes. However, when it comes to us as people, our lifestyle and our lives in general, we actually gravitate towards the norm. All right, so our eyes are naturally attracted to the things that are weird or abnormal, outside of the norm, but our lives oftentimes gravitate to things that are familiar, things that are routine, things that we're accustomed to, things that we are acquainted to. That's just how we are. We are creatures of habit. We don't like things to change too much. We don't like to veer too far from that which we are familiar with. If you don't believe me, let's just place this scenario out there for you for a minute and see if you would fall into this category. Say some friends of yours or maybe your spouse says, hey, let's go out to eat. Immediately, what goes through your mind? The list of restaurants that you are familiar with, maybe you've got two or three, or maybe you get that go-to that's always there. Immediately, something that's familiar already comes to your mind and you start to process which one of these places that I typically go to and are we going to go to tonight? And then, you know, you choose the restaurant and you go to the restaurant and then you proceed to order your food, right? What are you going to order? Something that is familiar to you. Most likely you've got one or two, maybe three things on the menu that you typically like. And you actually go to that restaurant because you like that thing. And to order something outside of the norm is to take a chance, and you might not want to do that, right? Now, say you actually had an opportunity to pick your seating in that particular restaurant. Most of us will sit in the same vicinity of where we typically sit. Why is this, guys? Because we are indeed creatures of habit, right? Our lifestyles go to the routine. It goes to the familiar. But it's not just our lifestyles. It's also our lives in general. We actually seek after that which is normal. We don't want to actually stand out. We don't want to veer too far from the average, because for some reason then we would actually stand out and other people might think that we are indeed weird. Now, there is a deeper psychology in all of this, and I'm just making kind of an observation from my perspective, and we're going to get into the theology of this here in a little bit, but there's definitely some deeper psychology in this. Why is it that we have this fear of stepping outside of the normal, stepping outside of the average in the ordinary? Maybe you've actually experienced what it feels like to step out of that. As a kid, maybe you stood out because of things that you liked or things that you wore, and because of that you were ridiculed or you were made fun of or you were bullied. As an adult, maybe stepping outside of the normal has cost you a job or maybe a relationship. There's a fear because there's a risk that comes along with us being outside of that which is normal. And therefore, we naturally gravitate our life and our lifestyles towards the norm, even though our eyes automatically go towards the things that are not normal. This is a really interesting concept. Now, one of the reasons why we're talking about this right now is because we're at a point in time in our society and in many of our lives, they've been uprooted. It has been flipped upside down by this whole crisis, this COVID stuff that's been going on. And so for the last several months, we've kind of been out of the norm and out of the routine. And I hear a lot of you saying this, man, I just can't wait till things get back to normal, right? Like we're all thinking this, we're all feeling this. There's a sense of familiarity that we're trying to get back to. Even starting to meet in person as a church, like this is, oh man, this feels so good because this is what was part of my routine. This was part of my habit. This is what is normal, right? And so we find ourselves longing to go back to normal. But let me ask you this question. What is normal? And is it working? Is it something that actually should be pursued? Is it something that we should be shooting for in the first place? We naturally gravitate toward it. I get it. I understand it. But is it really the very thing that we should actually be aiming for? And here's the deal. I would put this out to you. I would say that normal wasn't working beforehand. And therefore, I'd ask ourselves this question. Should we really be aiming for normal now? I get there's a sense of normalcy, and it's not necessarily bad to seek a sense of normalcy, but when we settle for normal, I think we might be settling for less than what God has actually intended for us. Now, we're going to talk about this from a couple different angles, but let's just start off. It doesn't matter if you're a follower of Jesus or not. I truly believe that normal is not working. And so let's take a look at what normal looks like for our society, for our American society. What is average? What does ordinary look like? And why is it not working? First of all, I would say this. Normal is broke. Now, I'm not the first one to say this. If you're a Dave Ramsey fan, you've listened to any of his stuff on Financial Peace University, he uses this phrase all the time. Normal is broke. But you don't have to be a Dave Ramsey fan to believe this. You can go to other national statistics and take a look at what the average person and their finances looks like. And to be honest with you, the normal American is chasing after success and spending more than you have, and there's no room to give. The average American has nearly 80% of the population. Nearly 80% of the population is living paycheck to paycheck. What that means is that they've not created any kind of margin in their life for any kind of crisis or for any kind of giving. There's no margin because it's whatever I'm bringing in, I'm spending at the end of the month. It's actually even worse than that because we not only have a lack of savings, we're told in some statistics that 70% of Americans don't even have up to $1,000 for an emergency in savings, but we actually have this greater amount of debt than we do actually income. On average, people are actually spending more than what they are bringing in a month. Guys, normal is broke. Normal is crazy. That is not a good way to live. And when you live normal and you live broke, then man, there's a lot of stress that comes along with that. That is not how we are called to live. That's not how any of us want to live, but that is in fact normal. Now, normal is not only broke, normal for us is also busy, isn't it? That is one of the most common phrases that you'll hear from people. If you ask them, hey, how you doing, you know, these days, their answer might be, well, I'm fine. But more often than not, you're going to hear the response, man, I'm just busy. And that is kind of the norm for people. It's also, for some weird, odd way, it's actually desired. It shows that, you know, somehow you're being productive, or at least it demonstrates the possibility that you are. And we actually seek productivity and success and rising more than we do health as Americans. And so busy is actually kind of sought after, but normal is busy, and busy is not good, guys. Yeah, the U.S. is actually notorious for being overworked, spending more hours in the office and less hours in vacation, less hours in resting. I actually saw this statistic from the ILO, and it says this: Americans work 137 more hours per year than Japanese workers, 260 more hours per year than British workers, and 499 more hours per year more than French workers. And there's something inside of you that's saying, yeah, we're first, right? I mean, there's something inside of us that actually, like, applauds that. But guys, busy is not how we were intended. I've actually been reading several books here recently, and they've been super convicting about the concept of Sabbath and the need for rest, and how God actually designed us for this. And I'm not going to get into all that right now, but we are actually created to rest, to work really hard, but then to actually to rest. And we don't do that. Not only do we not do that in our work life, but we don't do that in our family lives. Our families are so busy. I talk to friends of mine all the time. It's like, hey, I'd like to get together with you, and just trying to coordinate schedules between everything that we got going on. It's crazy. And you know what I'm talking about, right? In between piano recitals and soccer practice and band practice and youth events and school events and PTO stuff and everything else that you put on the calendar, it's like you're grabbing meals in between things. You're not sitting down. You're not able to actually get to hang out with your family. You're just kind of getting through life because we're just busy. That's kind of the nature of our life. But you know what? It's normal. It's normal. So is it okay? I'm telling you, normal is not working, even though normal is busy. Without time to unwind, time to take care of your home, spend time with loved ones, enjoy your hobbies, connect with friends, and generally live a more balanced life, you are going to be prone to stress. And stress is the number one cause of health problems, both mentally and physically. But go ahead and be busy, because busy is normal. You're just going to be stressed out of your gourd. Is that what you want? Because that's what normal looks like. No time for rest, no time for friendships, no time to concentrate on the things that truly matter in this life. You know, normal is also bitter. Normal is bitter. And here's what I mean by that. Normal people are unforgiving people. Normal people find the divide, the difference between what I believe and what you believe. And when you create a divide and you create a chasm and you create a category, it makes it really easy to start to hate people. We talked about this a couple weeks ago. But we live in kind of a dog-eat-dog society. We live in kind of a me society, an unforgiving, holding grudges, burning bridges kind of mentality. And that is actually the norm. And maybe you have really good reason to be bitter. Maybe somebody has personally hurt you. Or maybe there's a group of people that have done something to another person that you happen to care about. And so it is normal for us to be able to be bitter towards other people, or to hold grudges, or to cause difference between other people. But that's not good. That is not what God has called us to. That is not how we want to live. But that is the reality. Relationships go south. Friendships are unmended. Divorce rates are on the rise. All this kind of stuff happens because that's what's normal. And if we settle for normal, then we'll end up being bitter like the rest of the world. Normal is bossy. Normal is bossy. Using authority to lord it over other people. See, we desire control or significance, and we do whatever it takes in order for us to get there. And what that means is sometimes we use whatever authority or whatever power, or whatever influence that we have in order to be able to step on other people, to get to other people to do things that they're supposed to do in order for us to feel better about ourselves. That happens in our family as kids, in the order of our families. It happens in our corporations and in our businesses. It happens in our neighborhoods. It happens in our churches. We use our position or authority to get what we want because we care more about ourselves than we do about others. And it leads us to being bossy. And bossy is normal. And here's the deal, guys, just in general, bossy, I mean, normal is boring. It's just boring. Who wants to be average? Who wants to be ordinary? I don't think any of us really want to be, but we don't have the courage to stand out from the crowd. You see, normal is not working. Yet for some reason, we find ourselves continuing to go back to it, seeking it, pursuing it, leaving aside the extraordinary things that actually are inside of us in order to be able to settle for that which is normal and average, because we don't want to be weird. We don't want to be called out. We don't want to stand out. And like a dog returns to his vomit, we return to the familiar. And guys, we're at a place right now where we have to be careful. Because right now with this corona crisis that has come upon us, we actually have this really incredible opportunity that's given to us. We have a tremendous blessing to actually reflect and reevaluate and recenter and even reset our norm. We have the ability to do that, but for a lot of us, we are so concerned about getting back to the familiar, getting back to the normal, that we might miss out on the extraordinary that God wants to do in and through us. You see, what we've become accustomed to within our lives has been in large part, we've missed the mark of the life that God has actually called us to. Now, let me be abundantly clear here, all right? Seeking a sense of normalcy is not necessarily a bad thing. That's not what I'm talking about, okay? Seeking a sense of normalcy is not necessarily a bad thing, but settling for normal is. Settling for normal is. Because pursuing the familiar oftentimes can be an affront to following Jesus. Now again, let me be abundantly clear. Normal is not working regardless of where you find yourself at in your journey with Jesus. It's just not working. But if you happen to be a follower of Christ, then settling for the normal can actually be an affront to following Jesus. And so if we're following Jesus, guys, we should actually be shooting for not normal. That's what this whole series is about. Now, if you call yourself a follower of Jesus, we are actually called to be different. Rhythms and routines, like I get those. Those are good. They can be very, very healthy. Those aren't necessarily bad. But settling for normal when normal isn't working is, because we are actually called. We are called to be holy. Now, that word holy actually means to be set apart. It means called out from, different from the rest of the world. Like, God had called the nation of Israel to be set apart from the rest of the world. He's called us as followers of Jesus to actually be set apart from the rest of the world. We are called to be holy. Paul puts it in these terms in Romans chapter 12. He says this, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what the good and acceptable and perfect will of God is." Now, let me point out to you this top line here. It says, do not be conformed to this world. In other words, don't let the world and this desire to be normal and to not stand out, don't let that be the thing that attracts you, the thing that draws you in. Actually be set apart. Do not be conformed by this world, but be transformed by Jesus. He's calling us to stand out, to be different, to be set apart. Now, guys, this doesn't mean that we should seek to be weird, all right? Every single one of us, like, we know weird people, right? We know weird Christians. Most of us have a weird cousin or a weird neighbor or a weird coworker, and they pop up to your mind and you're like, I don't want to be like them, right? They're just weird, and they actually detract people. But we should look a little different to the rest of this world. Maybe significantly different. Our outlook and our perspective should be different. The way we treat people, the way we handle our finances, the way that we open our home, and the way that we use our stuff, it should be noted by people who are not yet following Jesus. The way we raise our kids or love our spouses or interact with our neighbors or go out of our way as friends to support those that are less fortunate, all of those things should be signs that we are actually standing out from the rest of this world. Now, guys, I got to tell you, I have this dilemma just in my own personal life. And the dilemma is that I'm a pastor. And that's not a bad thing, all right? Don't think it's a bad thing. I don't think it's a bad thing. But what happens is when I meet somebody new, oftentimes I will delay as long as I can for them to know that I'm a pastor. And you might be thinking, well, why would you do that? And here's why, because when I let somebody know that I'm a pastor, something in them changes, like my interaction with them or their interaction with me, it changes. Sometimes for the good, sometimes for the bad, but it always changes, it shifts. Now, while I want to wait as long as I possibly can for somebody to know that I'm a pastor, I want them to know right from the beginning, by the way I live my life, by the way in which I've set myself apart, by the way I speak and interact and treat other people, I want them to know that I'm a follower of Jesus. Now, this may be convicting for some of you because there are some of you that are calling yourself followers of Jesus. But those that you interact with on a daily basis, maybe the people that have known you for a long period of time, they would have absolutely no clue that you belong to Jesus by the way that you live your life, by the way in which you speak, by the way in which you treat other people, because it's the same as anybody else. The coarse jokes that you tell, the foul language that you use, the ways in which you look at people, view people, talk about people, divide people, whatever it happens to be, they would have no clue that you're actually following Jesus. If that happens to be you and you're listening to this today, let that be a wake-up call, because you have actually been called to be set apart, to look a little bit different than the rest of the world. People, they should know who you are. They should know whose you are by the way in which you love other people, by the way in which you live your life. And so if you never actually opened your words up and said, I'm a follower of Jesus, I am a Christian, I go to church, whatever it happens to be, people should still know that you follow Jesus because you've been set apart and you live your life differently. You don't just blend into the rest of the world. Now, if you're going to be different like Jesus. Be different like Jesus. Just so we're clear, we're not shooting for weird, all right? We're shooting for Jesus. But if we're shooting for Jesus, if we're aiming for Jesus, if we're going to be like him and do the things that he did and say the things that he said, understand that that should push us into the weird category for some people. That should push us into a place where we are not normal. We are not like everybody else. Because Jesus, I'm telling you, you read the scriptures, read the historical accounts of Jesus. He was not like other people. He stood out. Jesus actually describes it this way, how he wants us to be. And he describes it in a prayer that he prays to his Father in John chapter 17. You can go and read the rest of this, but this is kind of the synopsis of it. He says, Lord, I pray for them. They are not of this world, as I am not of this world. Okay? The people who are following me are just like me, and neither one of us are of this world. But then he says this. He says, but don't take them out of the world. Don't take them out of the world. In other words, we're supposed to be in the world, but not of the world. We're supposed to be able to relate to the world, but not look like the world. In other words, I need them to stand out in order to represent a different kind of life, a different kind of pursuit, a not normal way of living. That is Jesus's prayer for us, that we might be able to stand out in the world, but not of the world. Here's the deal, guys. As a church, trying to accomplish the mission that God has given us to be a people following Jesus to those not yet, we cannot accomplish our mission if we completely separate ourselves from the world. So some of you guys have been around groups like the Amish. I grew up in Kentucky. There was a group kind of like that. They're called the Shakers. And these people actually loved Jesus, but they completely separated themselves from the world. So yeah, they stood out. Yeah, they were weird, but they were also completely set apart, completely separated from the rest of the world. And therefore, they're not doing a whole lot to be able to reach people that are not yet so that they can actually know who Jesus is. They have separated themselves, segregated themselves from the rest of the world. Jesus is saying, that's not what I'm talking about here. And we cannot accomplish our mission if we completely separate ourselves. But we also cannot accomplish our mission if we don't set ourselves apart from the rest of the world, if we just look the same as the world as well. You see, if I'm putting our our mission into a new framework, it would be this. We need to be a not normal people following Jesus to those not yet. You know, on multiple occasions, you see this phrase throughout Scripture in Jesus' words. He'll say this. He says, you heard it said, but I say, or I tell you. You've heard it said. This is how, like, most people do this. This is how you have been instructed in the past. This is the ordinary or the normal way to be able to react. But I tell you this. What he's saying is normal people believe this. They do this. They think this. They act like this. But I'm actually calling you to be not normal. In Matthew chapter 5, verse 38, he actually gives us a couple of these instances. But he says this. You've heard it said, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. You know, in other words, when someone slaps you on the face, you slap them back, right? But he says, but I tell you, there's a different way to live. And if you're following me, if you're entering into my kingdom, if you want to represent me and not be of this world, instead of an eye for an eye, when someone smacks you on the cheek, turn the other cheek. If somebody wants your tunic, then give them your cloak. If somebody asks you to go 1 mile, go 2 miles, because I'm calling you to be different than the rest of this world. He goes on to say in that same chapter, you've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy, right? But then he turns this thing on its head and he says, no, that's the normal response. The abnormal, the not normal, Jesus following response is actually to love your enemy and pray for them. The not normal response is to praise God in the middle of the storm, is to not be anxious whenever you've been diagnosed with cancer, is to forgive the person that has caused you so much harm. That is the not normal response. And when people see you doing these things and acting these ways, they scratch their head and they go, I wonder what they got that I don't. That's what Jesus is calling us to. You see, you and I are not supposed to seek the norm. We're supposed to seek Jesus, and he is nothing like the norm. We're not supposed to act like the rest of society. We are called to actually swim upstream. You know, I've talked to you guys about this Chosen series a couple times now, and it's so good. I want to continue to just put that out there. If you've not seen this, man, it would be a great thing for you to see. Just go onto YouTube and you can look up The Chosen and go check it out. But one of the things that I love, and I know this sounds weird, but they have this intro video, and I just love this intro video that they did. The music and the graphics, and it actually demonstrates exactly what we're talking about today, what it looks like to actually swim upstream. Take a look at this real quick. I absolutely love that intro. I love the graphic. It's so simple, but it represents what it looks like. When you're following Jesus, you're actually going to swim upstream. And when you do that, you're going to be noticed. You're going to stand out. And again, there's something in our intrinsic human nature that doesn't like to stand out. But in our spiritual nature, if we're followers of Jesus, man, we have to stand out in order for other people to know that there's a better way. Because normal is not working. Matthew chapter 20, he records these words of Jesus. Jesus calls these guys together, and they've been talking about, you know, who's going to be the, you know, best in the kingdom and who gets to sit on my right hand and left hand, all that kind of stuff. They're talking about the authority thing, which we talked about earlier, right? And, you know, normal is bossy, but Jesus says this. You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and the high officials exercise authority over them. In other words, you know how the rest of the world operates. You know how the rest of the world actually takes and looks at authority and ruling and all that kind of stuff and their interactions with other people. That's how normal people do this. I love this phrase. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. That's not normal. And whoever wants to be first must be your slave. You got to be kidding me. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. Not so with you. Not so with you. You shouldn't be like everybody else. You have been designed and created special and incredible and extraordinary. Why is it that we continue to gravitate towards the ordinary, toward the average, to the norm, when God has called us to do so much other than that? It's not so with you. If you're a follower of Jesus, step outside of the norm. I don't know about you, but I just resigned. I don't want to be normal anymore. I'm okay with standing out a little bit. I don't want to have a normal marriage that typically ends in divorce. That's the normal thing. I don't want to have a normal marriage that just simply survives and is able to say, hey, we had this many years, but we didn't have this exceptional marriage. I want to have an exceptional marriage. I don't want to raise normal kids. And thank goodness, because my kids are very abnormal anyway, right? But I don't want them to just be like normal. I don't want them to have normal jobs. I don't want them to have normal spouses. I don't want them to pursue normal things. I don't want them just to be safe and secure. I want them to live extraordinary lives and do extraordinary things. I don't want to be just a normal neighbor. I don't want to be a part of a normal church. I don't want to look back on my life someday and say, man, that was normal. That was average. That was ordinary. We have an opportunity to step outside of the ordinary. We actually have an obligation, if we're followers of Jesus, to step outside of the ordinary and live a life that is truly life that will then attract other people. Because remember, people are naturally attracted to those things that are outside of the ordinary. But they will not be attracted to you unless you step outside of the ordinary. And if they're not attracted to you, then they may never see Jesus, who is not normal. So if you've ever wanted to be different like Jesus, permission granted today. Here's the deal, guys. Over the next several weeks, we're going to dive into this a little bit further. I've just been kind of given the introduction to what this looks like. Normal's not working for anybody, right? But as a follower of Jesus, we're actually called not to be normal. Well, what does that look like in other aspects of our life? And that's what we're going to be taking a look at over the next 3 weeks. So I hope you come back and join us for that. With that being said, let me pray, and then we'll continue on with the rest of this gathering. Father, thank you for giving us insight and perspective that we desperately need, because if we don't do this, if we don't dedicate ourselves to being able to sit down and to listen and to learn, then we won't be able to hear things that challenge our perspectives, that challenge our pursuit. And so, Father, I thank you for those today that have been willing to show up and to hear this message. For many people, it's just a reminder. But for other people, Lord, this is a game changer, that they can actually step outside of the ordinary and it be okay. That they could be a little bit weird. Not that we're shooting for weird, but being like Jesus means being a little bit different. And that somehow, some way, that people would see our lives and they would ask us, who is it that you are following? What is it that causes you to stand out the way that you do? So Lord, I just pray that you would cause us as individuals, as people, as leaders, as church members and this church to be not normal. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.